receptivity is that a word?
Sure, packet.
Making diversity more explicit, that receptivity. Sounds like a word. Well, it's almost 1:50, welcome to our enormous audience. Delighted to see you all. Welcome to extemporaneous speech. This is the hardest category in the entire speech contest. Please set your phones to silent mode. The speeches will be filmed, it appears.
Oh, good.
Good, we have an audience, and more of an audience. And I'll wait until everybody comes in, and then I'll repeat my welcome. Okay. Anybody else? Okay. The speeches will be filmed and will be available on the CSN website, so it's not necessary to video them, so please don't make any video. That's being done by the video mistress. And please don't upload them to social media. Please enjoy the speeches. So our first speaker is Mr. Rohit Pongche, who will read out the topic that he has chosen to speak about in his speech with him.
Good afternoon. My name is Rohit, and the topic given to me was to discuss regional preparedness and cooperation in dealing with the nuclear armed North Korea. The data possessed by North Korea is not new. For a long time, the Kim regime has said that it's preparing a possible nuclear missile program. As a result, it possesses various nuclear weapons and long-range missiles. Moreover, it is trying to build more arms, such as the short-range missile and the intercontinental missiles, all of which can destroy cities within a matter of seconds. This has escalated tensions in the Korean Peninsula, as countries such as China, Japan, South Korea, and Russia are alarmed at the rate at which North Korea is launching its missiles. When it comes to matters of regional preparedness, Japan is leading the way. According to an article in Newsweek, written in June 2017 by Eleanor Ross, the Japan Air Defense Force is preparing for possible nuclear air missile attack by North Korea by testing the PAC-3. The PAC-3, also known as the Patriotic Advanced Capability, was built and developed by Lockheed Martin. Its aim, to hit and kill missiles. For example, if North Korea were to launch an air missile to Tokyo, then the PAC-3 would be deployed to detect and destroy this missile. Additionally, South Korea is also preparing for North Korean air missile attack. A CNN article written in July 2017 says that the United States South Korean forces is thinking of deploying the Terminal High Altitude Area Defense, also known as TAD. Like the PAC-3 deployed in Japan, the TAD system aims to protect the South Korean capital Seoul, which has one of the most dense populations in the world. Its aim is also to detect as well as destroy missiles. It has reached its initial operating capability and its aim to be deployed by the end of 2017. However, a CNBC article written in August 2017 called that China and Russia are denying preparing for a war in Asia. This is because China has put its bombers on a high alert. Reports coming out of China's capital, Beijing, says that 150,000 soldiers are being deployed along the South Korea and China's border. Also, Russian troops and arms are being transported to the nation's border with North Korea. This is under the pretext of a combat training program. As with any regional preparedness, there has to be regional cooperation. In the South China Morning Post, Robert Delamere writes in October 24th of 2017 that US, Japan, and South Korea are aiming to perform more joint air drills over the Korean Peninsula. This is to increase the ability to launch coordinated air response to North Korea in case of a North Korean missile crisis. Additionally, China and Russia are also performing naval exercises near the Russia and North Korea's border. This is to act as a deterrent for possible nuclear war. In conclusion, regional preparedness and regional cooperation are increasing in the Korean Peninsula, as countries involved in this crisis are hoping for that there's no nuclear war. And as of now, there might just be a light at the end of the tunnel. Thank you.
I think we're ready to start. If nobody else is coming in, audience members, please welcome to extemporaneous speech. Please set your phones to silent mode. These speeches are being filmed and will be available on the SACEN website. Therefore, there's no reason for you to film them yourself. Please don't upload them to social media. And please enjoy the speeches. Our next contestant, Hyokyung Song, will be talking about
government and industry would aid India in its construction of a bullet train. Discuss how the improved relations between Japan and India benefit the growth of each nation. The Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe met with his Indian counterpart, Prime Minister Modi, to discuss to boost the economic cooperation between the two countries in September of this year. Specifically, they discussed about the loan from Japan to India regarding the construction of a bullet train in the western part of the country. This loan amounts to $1.7 billion, so 0.1% interest rates for 50 years. At first glance, this seems to be an unbelievably generous loan from Japan to a developing nation. However, this may not be the case. In this speech, I'll discuss about the first, the political relationships of India and Japan. Second, economic perspective of Japan, and third, the economic perspective of India. This deal was finalized during a time of international political turmoil. The U.S. is currently failing as a global security guarantor, while North Korea is threatening the country with its nuclear weapons. In Asia, China is experiencing rapid growth. This required Japan and India to maintain close relationships Asia, looking for economic stability and control in the region. In the Carnegie Indian Director, C. Raja Mohan, is quoted in his interview at the Indian Express column as, quote, "China has never accepted that the subcontinent is India's exclusive sphere of influence. It now has the will and resources to challenge that premise, and India is scrambling for economic and strategic certainty region," end quote. Also, the Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe was quoted in his first post interview in September of 2015 that Japan and India are natural partners and that they will continue to increase their cooperation economically and politically. From the economic perspective of Japan, Japan is a nation that is fighting internal deflation. The statistics from JICA, quoted by Bloomberg this year, suggested that the 10-year yield of JGB, Japanese government bond, has fallen from 2.3% to 0.05%. Analysts from Leibniz in September of this year, article suggested that a 0.1% interest of this loan is reasonable to a country like Japan experiencing deflation. Researchers from First Post in their September 2017 article also suggested that Japan has historically offered loans to developing countries at similar interest of that of the JGB, and they are expecting and are receiving returns in services, resources, and economic cooperation. India, internally, is a developing country and requires stable infrastructure in the future. Analysts from Bloomberg in their September 2017 article suggested that this loan will help the economic campaign of Prime Minister Modi named Make in India because of the technology transfers from Japan during the construction. Japan is from a country which is long-term successful and has proven technology. As a result, this will support the Indian economy in the long run. In this speech, I've talked about, first, the politics between India and Japan regarding China, and second, the economic perspective of Japan, third, India. Although the future outcomes of big-scale investments like these are unpredictable, the close relationship between Japan and India might bring stability in times of economic and political turmoil. Thank you.
Thank you.
Four minutes, 22 seconds. Thank you.
next contestant, who should be here momentarily. I'll mention some things to the audience. Welcome to Tempranillo Speech. This is the most difficult and challenging of all of the speech categories, I think, is my opinion. Please set your phones to silent mode. The speeches are being filmed, and therefore it's not necessary for you to film them yourselves. They will be available on the SACEM website. Please don't upload any videos to social media.
First, my topic is JP1. Describe suggested amendments to the 1946 Constitution. What are the effects of amending Article 9?
Start at any time when you're ready.
Japan's current constitution was first promulgated on November 3rd, 1946, and came to effect on May 3rd, 1947. Article 9, one of the constitution's distinctive features, renounces war and prohibits Japan from maintaining war potential, according to the Library of Congress. Prime Minister Shinzo Abe has said he aims to revise Japan's constitution according to an article from The Diplomat that was written on May 5th. He intends to amend the article in order to confirm Japan's self-defense force, which they currently have, which their existence somewhat contradicts with the Article 9. This revision or amendment to the Article 9 are expected to have numerous effects to Japan. In this speech, I would like to first talk about the effects to Japan's politics, and second, its impact to Japan and to its international relationship. First, the political stability. According to Japan Times article that was written on April 30th, a survey was done with 3,000 randomly selected Japanese people aged 18 or older. Questions that were sent by mail on regarding how they think about the amendment. About 19,944 valid responses came, and 49% said they agreed or supported the amendment, and 47 has said they opposed the amendment. Also, a survey done by the Mainichi Shimbun poll has showed 52% of opposed responses and 27% that was in favor. This division between people not only questions the necessity of the amendment, but also indicates a possible political instability after the amendment has taken place. If the Article 9 is amendment, the fact that Japanese citizens are not in consensus may lead to a political instability that can come from the lack of support from half of their citizens, according to the article that was stated previously. Second, the international relationship that Japan has. The relationship that will be focused on today will be U.S.-Japan relationship. So in a recent meeting with the Prime Minister of Abe and President Trump, President Trump addressed the trade relationship between the United States and Japan. He stated, according to the New York Times article that was published on November 6th, Prime Minister of Japan is going to be purchasing massive amounts of military equipment, as he should. It is clear that one of the intentions behind the amendment is from the North Korean threat that Japan has won this experience. As Prime Minister Abe has stated in mid-April, the security situation around our country is getting increasingly severe, according to a CNN article that was written on May 3rd. Looking at those two articles, after the amendment has taken place, it is clear that Japan needs to purchase more military supplies from the United States, and this indicates a positive relationship that can be experienced after the amendment. In conclusion, Prime Minister Shinzo Abe's intention on amending the Article 9 of Japan's Constitution will lead the is it intentions on amending the Article 9 has unstable effects.
Thank you very much. Time. I do that, excuse me, I need to give some reminders to some members of the audience who may have come in the interim. Please set your phones to silent mode. The speeches are being filmed and will be available on the SASM website, so there's no reason for you to film them yourselves. So please don't do that. Enjoy the speeches. Now, our next speaker is Mr. So from St. Mary's. He'll be speaking on a topic related to the Americas. The 2017 Atlantic hurricane season has been hyperactive this year. Discuss the impact these hurricanes will have upon the countries which are affected.
Can you turn the back, please?
Stop. Please start from here.
Can't see.
Hurricanes Harvey and Irma have been dubbed as the most destructive hurricanes of the 2017 Atlantic hurricane season. Hurricane Harvey was the first to strike. On August 26th, Harvey ripped through Texas and the southern United States, dumping an estimated 27 trillion gallons of rain over 6 days and decimating everything in its path. Harvey was soon followed by Irma on September the 10th, which wreaked havoc on the southeast United States and the Caribbean islands. The 2017 Atlantic hurricane season has been especially hyperactive and has been responsible for unprecedented losses of human lives and destruction in both the United States and the Caribbean nations, with major political and economic repercussions. In my speech today, I would like to first discuss the impact of the hurricanes on the United States, and second, on the Caribbean nations. Please note that although there has been several Atlantic hurricanes this year, I'll be focusing on Hurricanes Harvey and Irma because they have had the biggest impact on the region. First of all, let's look at the impact that these hurricanes have had on the United States, not only economically, but also politically. According to the August 30th article of the BBC, Hurricanes Harvey and Irma have thought to have been responsible for an estimated $190 billion worth of damages to property. For example, as many as 500,000 cars and trucks are thought to have been damaged. To make matters worse, according to the September the 1st article on CNN, as much as 31% of total U.S. oil refining capacity has been taken offline as a result of the two hurricanes. This is significant because as much as 20% of Texas's GDP and 10% of Florida's GDP comes from the oil industry, and the hurricanes' destruction of oil refineries and offshore drilling facilities will deny these two states a major source of income for the foreseeable future. However, the U.S. economy is expected to recover as oil refineries and its offshore drilling facilities come back online and properties are repaired. Hurricane Irma, which hit Florida and Costa Rica, also rendered enormous damage to the tourism industry there. Florida's GDP is expected to decrease by 2.5% this year, while according to the September the 6th article of Forbes, Florida's economy is expected to recover as residents return and consumer spending increases. Indeed, the hurricanes have rendered an enormous damage on the U.S. economy. GDP growth in the United States this year is estimated to shrink as much as 1% as a direct result of the hurricanes. However, the U.S. economy is expected to recover due to the sheer strength and might of the U.S. financial system. However, the hurricanes have brought significant long-term political repercussions for the United States. In the aftermath of Hurricane Harvey, the Trump administration was heavily criticized for its lackluster response and an alleged inability to empathize with those affected after it was revealed that President Trump had been golfing as Mar-a-Lago resort. According to the September 20th article in the New York Times, the Trump administration has been even slower in delivering aid to Florida and Costa Rica in the aftermath of Hurricane Irma. In fact, Trump himself antagonized relations with Costa Ricans by accusing their governor of being, quote, incompetent. As Jeremy Pine, an analyst at Politics Daily, told the September 10th article of the BBC, quote, the president's inflammatory comments have made him look like a hypocrite in the eyes of the American public. Here he was, taking days to deliver aid to the affected regions, yet he was accusing local officials of being incompetent. Indeed, Trump's approval ratings have nosedived 6% in the weeks following the hurricanes, and undermine his authority as president and increase political uncertainty in the United States. Next, let's look at the impact of the hurricanes on the Caribbean nations. According to the September 10th article of The Economist, the 2017 hurricane season has been responsible for at least $45 billion worth of damages to the Caribbean islands. Caught directly in the crosshairs of Irma, entire villages and towns have been leveled, and at least 380 people lost their lives. It is important to note that the Caribbean islands rely heavily on tourism as a major source of income for the economy, because as much as 30% of total GDP depends on the tourism industry. However, the loss of infrastructure vital to tourism, including hotels, bridges, and the Spain beaches, would deny the Caribbean islands a major source of income for at least the upcoming foreseeable future. To make matters worse, the sheer destruction of the hurricanes may have hurt the island's image as a perfect getaway place, which may have a long-term detrimental impact on the tourism industry and hence the nation's economies. In conclusion, as a result of the 2017 hurricane season, the United States and the Caribbean islands will suffer politically and economically. The hurricanes were not just natural disasters. It was very much a political and economic one.
To our audience, to the contemporary speech category. Please set your phones to silent mode. The speeches are being filmed, and so there is no need for you to film them on your phones or other devices, and please do not upload them to social media. And our next speaker is Vaishnavi Garantia. I hope I haven't butchered your name too much.
Recently, on October 13th, President Trump has decertified the international nuclear deal. In short, according to a cover story from Council on Foreign Relations published on October 2017, the Iranian deal states that Iran has to dismantle much of its nuclear program, and in return, the U.S., China, France, Russia, the U.K., and Germany will relax its sanctions, which have previously crippled its economy. The agreement was made in 2015 under former U.S. President Barack Obama. The Iranians are most likely to return back to its nuclear program now that the Iranian deal was decertified. According to a piece from The Atlantic published on 2017, many former Obama administration officials believe Iranians would stop complying with the deal and ramp up their nuclear program if the U.S. were to reverse course on the sanction relief. I believe that this is true because according to another cover story from BBC News published on October 2017, Iran has so far satisfied many of the deal restrictions and has reduced a lot of the centrifuges that it has been using in order to create bombs. In fact, previously there were 20,000 centrifuges that allow Iran to make 8 to 10 bombs. However, they have significantly reduced the number. Since President Trump has stated that this has been a very one-sided transaction, it will make the Iranians believe that it will make Iranians very suspicious of the U.S. because while the Iranians have been satisfying the deal, the U.S. has in fact said that they haven't been satisfying the deal. According to a cover story from Vox, published on October 2017, the International Atomic Energy Agency has repeatedly confirmed that Iran has complied with the deal's restrictions. Now, since the Iranians have been satisfying the deal, it will make the Iranians very suspicious of the U.S. According to a cover story from Forbes, October 2017, the decision to decertify the deal will give hardliners for people who have been preaching that the U.S. has the international nuclear deal is not okay because it restricts their program. These people, it will give more power to these people compared to President Rouhani because these people have been certified in their thinking that they have been doing so far. In conclusion, while it is possible for Iran to stay in the deal, it is quite likely for Iran to step out of the nuclear deal because the hardliners will have more power over President Rouhani. Thank you.
Judges are writing their comments for the previous speech, and so we'll wait for a few minutes. Our next speaker will be coming soon, but we won't start immediately. So please take your seats and make yourselves comfortable.
Grocer. Ms. Rose will be talking on America's topic number 6 on universal single payer health care. For the audience members, welcome. We're very happy to have you here. This is the most interesting of all the categories, and we're a very good choice of your time. Please set your phones to silent mode. Speeches are being filmed. You can move up, and everybody, plenty of good seats. The speeches are being filmed and will be available on the SASN website, so it's not necessary for you to film them. Please don't, and please don't upload them to social media. Have you talked with the timekeeper to? So please read your topic out loud, and the timing will begin after you finish reading it.
So, is there a realistic future for universal health care in the United States? One of the most divided topics of conversation between Republicans and Democrats in the United States is the topic of American health care insurance. And with the failure of Republicans replacing the American Health Care Act in June, it is unsure what the next steps are for the American health care system. One of the most notable health policy goals was one that was proposed by Bernie Sanders on September 13th, known as the Single Payer Bill. But it left questions to the Senate, the government, and the American population of whether there is a realistic future for universal health care in the United States. The single-payer system is one that the government will pay all medical necessities and services with little to no private insurance. This differs to the current system of the Affordable Care Act, where at the moment the government pays a large amount of insurance but lets people opt to pay private insurance. The Democrats were let down after Obamacare and called for health care that would provide all insurance to all Americans, as 28 million people in the United States are still uninsured. The plan promises for people to choose their own doctor, it lowers the cost of drugs, and gives comprehensive coverage for services like mental health and maternity leave. However, President Trump and the Republicans disagree with this proposed bill. In a tweet by Donald Trump on September 15th, he stated that Bernie Sanders is pushing hard for a single-payer system, a curse on the U.S. and its people. Republicans have talked about the massive waiting lists and delays that could be life-threatening from a single-payer system. Joelle White, the president of the Council of the American Health Commission, on September 20th said, "In other countries, we have seen single-payer bills showing us that putting more control of health care into the hands of politicians is bad medicine. It costs us a lot, taxes will rise, and patient access will be severely diminished." Michael Tanner from the Cato Institute also told CNN on September 20th, "I want people to understand there is a trade-off involved with a single-payer bill." The Republicans' predictions include things like the lower class and middle class being affected with the devaluing of the economy. According to the Congressional Budget Office, Medicare has already put the United States into $50 trillion of debt. And since Bernie Sanders' announcement of the bill, he stated on September 25th the price tag of about $1.38 trillion is associated with the single-payer bill. However, other experts project that the cost could be even higher, with the Urban Institute saying it could cost the American economy $2.5 trillion per year, and the Committee of Responsible Federal Budgets estimating it to be as high as $2.8 trillion per year for the American economy. The debate on healthcare still remains controversial, and the future of the single-payer bill being issued is one that is still up in the air. With Republicans and Democrats still disagreeing on whether this will be an effective bill, it is still controversial on whether a realistic future for the universal health care in the United States exists. Thank you.
Thank you.
his speech to the audience, read out his topic to the audience, and then the timing will begin after reading the topic.
Good afternoon. My topic is Asia-Pacific 3. Discuss the effects that Xi Jinping's anti-corruption campaign is having upon the Communist Party of China. How is this related to the recent strengthening of his hold on power following the Communist Party of Congress? In recent days, we have all been focusing on the news, what's happening and what has happened. Well, something has been dominating both the TV and the newspaper, and that is the meeting of Trump and Xi Jinping. This is one of the most internationally concerned meetings between the two superpowers of the world, Xi Jinping and Trump. It's everywhere. Well, what's going on? They are trying to construct a more bilateral trade and economic tie between the two strongest economic powers in the world, and something that Trump has always been fighting for. And this is how he became the president, by fighting for trade deficits, against trade deficits. Even though it was considered generally successful, for example, from a BBC report on the meeting, $250 billion of trade deals have been signed between the two leaders. Both sides have still not found common ground in many of its issues, including the existing North Korean missile crisis or the blaming of China for US's trade deficits. Yet one thing is clear and recognizable in the world, and that is China is a superpower, and we cannot ignore China's influence in the political arena. Well, there is a false belief that we all know about it. Does China really experience much change in its politics? We all know that it did experience change in its economics. From the 1980s onward, China has been soaring high in its GDP, and now it is the second most powerful country in economics. Well, people believe that China doesn't simply because it's a one-party rule and China is communist. There is no change, right? This is false. Because of this, many people would assert even more misunderstanding on why China has become what it is today. Well, China's change in politics is on the same level as its change in economics. China has become so powerful because China is much stabilized in its politics. And most importantly, there are a few changes that China has never seen before that is going to bring China into the next level. What we're talking about is Xi Jinping. In the latest and most recent National Congress of the Communist Party, China is beginning to understand what Xi is aiming for, and that is higher goals in economics by ways of innovation and technology. But also, because of this, Xi Jinping is asserting a new philosophy called Xi Jinping 新时代中国特色社会主义思想。It means Xi Jinping's thought on new socialism with Chinese characteristics in the new era. What it's aiming for is, as I've mentioned, new ways of gaining power by influence and trade, but most importantly, anti-corruption. Corruption has been such a huge problem to basically all the countries in the world, but corruption is very, very, very existent in Chinese history. In fact, most of China's most glorious and most powerful dynasties ended because of corruption. We all know about the eunuchs, right? The eunuchs were people that had high power, but because of what they have done, China's money and China's basically power has been lost in a few men. Well, Xi Jinping's campaign is known as the crackdown of the tigers and flies. From this phrase, we can understand that Xi Jinping is fighting against all sorts of people, from tigers to flies. This means from major to minor power, from important to less important people in the party. Xi Jinping is ready to exterminate any issue that is stopping it. Well, why is China so concerned about corruption in the recent days? Well, this is all because of the year 2012. 2012 was one of China's most tremendous change because of a huge shift in leadership. Why was there a change in leadership? Well, first of all, the Congress of China that is being held annually is for a change of leadership. That is one of its main concerns. But most importantly, because there was so much corruption going on ranging from big cities in the East Coast to tiny villages on the West. One of the most concerned men was Bo Xilai. Well, you guys might have heard of him from news, but Bo Xilai was such a huge problem because, first of all, Bo Xilai was considered one of the most brilliant. In fact, Bo Xilai was one of the competitors of Xi Jinping when they were trying to aim for the leadership. Wojcicki also had a huge tie with Mao Zedong when his father and Mao Zedong fought for Chinese Revolution. So many people would thought that Xi Jinping knew what's going on, but Xi Jinping wouldn't have the courage to do so. Yet Xi Jinping did. With Wojcicki, and according to the BBC, at least 7 important positions were being eradicated by Xi Jinping, which was the newest leader and one of the youngest in Chinese history. So the question for today is, what is the impact of this? And what is China going to do about it? Is China going to fall into a one-man rule because Xi Jinping is simply holding his power with these ways? Well, we all know it and you know it. There is no clear answer because this is so new and this is such a huge problem that we cannot simply give a yes or no answer. But we all know that China has learned from its lessons, from corruption, from one-man rule, from basically bad politics. And we all know that one day China will be ready to take on the world with more friendly ways and less political but negative ways.
Thank you. Thank you.